Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Human Rights, a Very Short Introduction, Second Edition, by Andrew Clapham, narrated by Peter Lerman. Publisher's note, in this audio edition you will hear references to figures present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Preface. The aim of this book is to provide the listener with some entry points into the worlds of human rights thinking, activism, and law. This book concentrates on the power of ideas to mobilize people against injustice and indignities. Human rights do not really resolve the tension between competing interests and various visions of how the world should be. Rather, human rights ideas provide a vocabulary for arguing about which interests should prevail and how to create the conditions for constraining attacks on dignity. This short introduction focuses on the content of a number of rights rather than simply telling the human rights story of revolutions, proclamations, and continuing struggles. Calling for a world based on respect for human rights is easy. Adjusting current arrangements to achieve full respect for human rights is a never-ending process. Even more difficult when we consider that human rights are not just an ideal, but actually consist of concrete rights to life, liberty, equality, free speech, privacy, health, food, and housing. Human rights are about each of us living in dignity, and we are a long way from achieving that on a global scale. We shall see that the Human Rights Project is not simply about implementing a set of obligations fixed in history. Rather, the human rights movement is about people standing up to injustice and showing solidarity in the face of oppression. In order to allow listeners to discover for themselves some of the texts and organizations referred to in this introduction, there is an accompanying website, graduateinstitute.ch/clapham-human-rights. The full text of most references can be found on this website. Chapter 1. Looking at Rights. These days, it is usually not long before a problem is expressed as a human rights issue. This book looks at where the concept of human rights came from and how the human rights movement has developed a set of obligations that apply worldwide. We will consider the trajectory of the idea of human rights and the role that human rights play and might come to play in our world. Different people currently see human rights in different ways. For some, invoking human rights is a heartfelt, morally justified demand to rectify all sorts of injustice. For others, it is no more than a slogan to be treated with suspicion or even hostility. Lawyers sometimes consider that human rights represent almost a term of art, representing only those claims that have been or can be upheld as legal rights by a national or international court. Yet the application of human rights law in court is almost always contested, with both parties to a dispute demanding that human rights law be applied in their favor. Human rights law is special and popular, as it often suggests that other law is inadequate or applied in an unfair way. The language of human rights is deployed to criticize, defend, and reform all sorts of behavior. Human rights have a pedigree of a distinguished struggle against oppression and the promise of a fairer future. Playing the human rights card can be persuasive, sometimes even conclusive, in contemporary decision-making. This is one aspect of what makes the moral force of human rights so attractive. Human rights help you win arguments and, sometimes, to change the way things are done. The concept of a human rights culture also means different things to different people. To some, it means ensuring that everyone is treated with respect for their inherent dignity and human worth. To others, it means that judges, the police, and immigration officials are required to protect the interests of terrorists, criminals, and migrants at the expense of the security of the population. This tension has come to a head in some countries, including the United Kingdom, with popular newspapers ridiculing the application of human rights legislation and campaigning against the role of foreign judges. At times, human rights protections may indeed seem to be anti-majoritarian. Why should judges or international bodies determine what is best for any society, especially when democratically elected representatives have chosen a particular path? But the point is that human rights may serve to protect people from the tyranny of the majority. Human rights law, however, should not be seen as a simple device to thwart the wishes of the majority, as, with the exception of the absolute ban on torture, it does in fact allow for security needs and the rights of others to be taken into consideration in a democratic society. There is no easy answer to this conundrum that asks why judges should be entitled to uphold human rights in the face of democratic decisions. Different societies will choose different arrangements. Some will place more power in the hands of judges than others. These arrangements may change over time. There is no perfect balance. There is no perfect judge. Sometimes judges may be seen by some as able to rein in a government that unjustifiably tramples human rights. But that same judgment may be seen by others as upholding the rights of property owners or employers at the expense of a popular legislature mandated to protect vulnerable workers or racial groups. Arguing about rights is a way to argue about what sort of society we want. Rights to freedom of expression and information can be useful in ensuring that we have full democratic decision-making, and the same human rights can also be used to challenge the resulting legislation. Whether those claiming rights are actually right is something which we can only know in context. So let us try to be a bit more concrete. We first need to understand that human rights are a special, narrow category of rights. William Edmondson's introductory book on rights distinguishes human rights from other rights by suggesting that human rights recognize extraordinarily special basic interests, and this sets them apart from rights, even moral rights, generally. Richard Falk suggests that human rights are a new type of rights, achieving prominence as a result of the adoption of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights by the United Nations in 1948. This point is worth remembering throughout the book. We are not talking about all the rights that human beings may have. We are considering a rather special category of rights. The elevation of human rights to the international level after the Second World War has meant that behavior can be judged not only against what national law requires, but also against a standard which sits outside a national system. Every nation-state is now subject to this scrutiny from outside. Many who approach the subject of human rights turn to early religious and philosophical writings. In their vision of human rights, human beings are endowed, by reason of their humanity, with certain fundamental and inalienable rights. This conclusion has existed in various forms in various societies. The historic development of the concept of human rights is often also associated with the evolution of Western philosophical and political principles. Yet a different perspective could find reference to similar principles concerning mass education, self-fulfillment, respect for others, and the quest to contribute to others' well-being in Confucian, Hindu, or Buddhist traditions. Religious texts such as the Bible and the Quran can be read as creating not only duties, but also rights. Recognition of the need to protect human freedom and human dignity is alluded to in some of the earliest codes, from Hammurabi's code in ancient Babylon, around 1780 BCE, right through to the natural law traditions of the West, which built on the Greek Stoics and the Roman law notion of jus gentium, law for all peoples. Common to each of these codes is the recognition of certain universally valid principles and standards of behavior. These behavioral standards arguably inspire human rights thinking and may be seen as precursors to, or different expressions of, the idea of human rights. but the lineage is not as obvious as is sometimes suggested. Let us now look at some early historical invocations of the actual concept of rights, as opposed to decent behavior, and the skeptical responses they evoked. Human rights and the British backlash. Chris Grayling, MP, in the Daily Mail, 2014. We must seize power from Euro judges and return the phrase human rights to what it really should be, a symbol of the fight against oppression and brutality. Prisoners being allowed artificial insemination treatment in order to protect their family rights, votes for prisoners in our jails. No whole life sentences for the most brutal murderers. No deportation for terrorists. Some of the decisions that the European Court of Human Rights has taken in recent years. And we came within one vote from one judge of being required to permit U.S.-style political TV advertising. These are not great principles of human rights. They are decisions taken by a court made up of people who are not by any means all legally qualified. That sees the original European Convention as a living instrument to be rewritten as the years go by. All of them should be matters for our Parliament and not for the courts to decide, but right now they aren't. Quite simply, that is not what we signed up to. So the next Conservative government will sort this out once and for all. We won't walk away from the principles of human rights, but we will say very clearly that we are a sovereign nation which upholds the best of human rights and that decisions about our nation should be taken by our Parliament. Susan Marks, 2014, Backlash, The Undeclared War Against Human Rights. There is the same kind of reactive assault that Faludi described in her account of the backlash against women's rights in America. It is the likewise limited gains of the human rights movement that are now to be rolled back. There is the same pattern whereby, in our case, human rights are blamed for producing the very condition they purport to remedy. That is to say, subjection, insecurity, unfreedom. There is the same sense of undeclared or covert war. As they tell it, these critics are not out to destroy human rights. On the contrary, they are the real defenders of human rights and fundamental freedoms. In the face of the depredations of a human rights movement bent on conceptual inflation and institutional overreach. The rights of man and their discontents. The standard Western account of the tradition of human rights is somewhat problematic. Early legal developments in the area of human rights are said to have emerged from the Magna Carta of 1215, a contract between the English King John and the barons, who were dissatisfied with the taxes being levied by the monarch. But although this agreement guaranteed rights for a freeman not to be arrested or detained in prison, or deprived of his freehold, or outlawed, or banished, or in any way molested, unless by lawful judgment of his peers and the law of the land, this guarantee was simply a right to trial by jury granted exclusively to property-owning men. The rights contained in the Magna Carta were part of a political settlement to entrench liberties of the governed and limit the powers of the government. Human rights, as that term is understood today, belong to all human beings and therefore cannot be restricted to a select group of privileged men. From a contemporary perspective, the Magna Carta cannot really be seen as an exemplary human rights declaration. Suffice it to cite one sentence. Clause 54 of the Magna Carta reads, "No one shall be arrested or imprisoned on the appeal of a woman for the death of any person except her husband." The English Bill of Rights of 1689 is similarly sometimes considered a stepping stone to today's text. It declared that excessive bail ought not to be required, nor excessive fines imposed, nor cruel and unusual punishments inflicted. It also declared, however, that the subjects which are Protestants may have arms for their defense suitable to their conditions, and as allowed by law. The Bill of Rights was developed by Parliament as a declaration of rights in response to the ideas and policies of King James II, who was perceived to be altering the nature of the state and introducing too much tolerance for Catholicism, and presented to the incoming joint sovereigns, William and Mary, as a condition for their ascension to the throne in order to vindicate ancient rights and liberties, protect freedom of speech, and limit interference by the sovereign in Parliament and elections. At the same time, the work of a number of philosophers had a very concrete influence on the articulation of demands in the form of natural rights, or the rights of man. John Locke's Second Treatise of Government, published in 1690, considered men in a state of nature, where they enjoyed a state of liberty, yet it was not a state of license. Locke reasoned that everyone is bound to preserve himself, so when his own preservation is not threatened, everyone should, as much as he can, preserve the rest of mankind, and no one may take away or impair the life or what tends to the preservation of the life, the liberty, health, limb, or goods of another. In this way, men may be restrained from invading others' rights and from doing hurt to one another. Locke saw civil government as the remedy for men acting as their own judges to enforce the law of nature. He considered that this social contract, freely entered into, entitled the government to enforce laws for as long as the government respected the trust placed in it. Should the people be subject to the exercise by the government of arbitrary or absolute power over their lives, liberties, and estates, then, according to Locke, governmental power would be forfeited and devolve back to the people. The social contract of Jean-Jacques Rousseau developed the idea that an individual may have a private will, volonté particulière, and that his private interest, intérêt particulière, may dictate to him very differently from the common interest. Rousseau considered that whoever refuses to obey the general will shall be compelled to it by the whole body. This, in fact, only forces him to be free. For Rousseau, man loses by the social contract his natural liberty and an unlimited right to all which tempts him and which he can obtain. In return, he acquires civil liberty and proprietorship of all he possesses. Published in 1762, the social contract was a precursor to the French Revolution of 1789. And the ideas it expressed have had considerable influence around the world as people have sought to articulate the rights of the governors and the governed. Thomas Paine was a radical English writer who participated in the revolutionary changes affecting America. He emigrated to America in 1774 and in 1776 produced a widely read pamphlet called Common Sense, which attacked the idea of rule by monarchy and called for republican government and equal rights among citizens. He also worked on the 1776 Constitution of Pennsylvania and for the subsequent abolition of slavery in that state. Paine's publication, entitled Rights of Man, appeared in 1791 as a defense of the French Revolution in response to Edmund Burke's Reflections on the Revolution in France. Paine was popular with the people. One estimate suggests that various versions of Rights of Man sold 250,000 copies in 2 years. He was unpopular with the government and was convicted in his absence of seditious libel at the Guildhall in London. The crowds flocked to support his defense counsel, protesting the trampling of the liberty of the press. Paine had by then already escaped to France and was rewarded with election to the National Convention for his defense of the Revolution. He was, however, later imprisoned, having angered the Jacobins for opposing the execution of the king. He himself escaped the death penalty. According to some accounts, the chalk mark was put on the wrong side of the door, and later left for America, where he died unfettered in 1809. His writings still resonate, and one does not have to look far to find bumper stickers and badges with Paine's aphorism from his Rights of Man. My country is the world, and my religion is to do good. Reading Pain reveals what it is that makes human rights such an enduring concept. Pain is sentimental about other people's suffering. When I contemplate the natural dignity of man, when I feel, for nature has not been kind enough to me to blunt my feelings, for the honor and happiness of its character, I become irritated at the attempt to govern mankind by force and fraud, as if they were all knaves and fools, and can scarcely avoid the disgust at those who are imposed upon. Paine railed against Burke for failing to feel any compassion for those who had suffered in the Bastille prison, and for being unaffected by the reality of distress. We can see here, I would suggest, the real seeds of the human rights movement, a feeling of sympathy for the distress of others, coupled with a sense of injustice when governments resort to measures which invade the perceived natural rights of the individual. The modern concept of human rights is thus traditionally easily traced to these ideas and texts adopted at the end of the 18th century. It is well known that the 1776 American Declaration of Independence stated, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness." The French Declaration of the Rights of Man and of the Citizen followed in 1789, and its familiar first two articles recognized and proclaimed that men are born and remain free and equal in rights, and that the aim of every political association is the preservation of the natural and inalienable rights of man. These rights are liberty, property, security, and resistance to oppression. Still, the rights they referred to were mostly relevant only to those states in relation to their citizens, and only specific groups could benefit from their protection. These revolutionary declarations represent attempts to enshrine human rights as guiding principles in the constitutions of new states or polities. The declarations were inspired by a liberal conception of society and a belief in natural law, human reason, and universal order. Rights were believed, by men, to be the exclusive property of those possessing the capacity to exercise rational choice, a group that excluded women. Attempts by Olympe de Gouges to promote, by appealing to Queen Marie Antoinette, a declaration of the rights of women and a social contract between man and woman, regulating property and inheritance rights, fell on deaf ears. In England, Mary Wollstonecraft's Vindication of the Rights of Woman appealed for a revision of the French Constitution to respect the rights of women, arguing that men could not decide for themselves what they judged and would be best for women. The denial of women's rights condemned women to the sphere of their families and left them groping in the dark. Karl Marx responded to the Proclamation of Rights in the Constitutions of Pennsylvania and New Hampshire and in the French Declaration by deriding the idea that rights could be useful in creating a new political community. For Marx, these rights stressed the individual's egoistic preoccupations rather than providing human emancipation from religion, property, and law. Marx had a vision of a future community in which all needs would be satisfied, and in which there would be no conflicts of interest, and therefore no role for rights or their enforcement. Marx also highlighted the puzzle that if rights can be limited for the public good, then the proclamation that the aim of political life is the protection of rights becomes convoluted. In the 19th century, natural rights, or the rights of man, became less relevant to political change, and thinkers such as Jeremy Bentham ridiculed the idea that all men are born free as absurd and miserable nonsense. Bentham famously dismissed natural and imprescriptible rights as nonsense upon stilts, declaring that wanting something is not the same as having it. In Bentham's terms, hunger is not bread. For Bentham, real rights were legal rights, and it was the role of lawmakers and not natural rights advocates to generate rights and determine their limits. Bentham considered that one was asking for trouble, inviting anarchy even, to suggest that government was constrained by natural rights. The contemporary scholar Amartya Sen has recalled Bentham's influence and highlighted a legitimacy critique whereby some see human rights as pre-legal moral claims that can hardly be seen as giving justiciable rights in courts and other institutions of enforcement. Sen cautions against confusing human rights with legislated legal rights. He also points to a further reaction to human rights discourse. It has been claimed by some that human rights are alien to some cultures, which may prefer to prioritize other principles, such as respect for authority. Sen calls this the cultural critique. This last criticism is a common preoccupation of commentators whenever the topic of human rights is raised. Indeed, the very short introduction to Empire suggests that, for some observers, the International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia, well known for the aborted trial of Slobodan Milosevic, is an imperialist creation, and that for such critics, the whole idea of universal human rights is actually a gigantic fraud, where Western imperialist or ex-colonial powers try to pass off their own very specific and localized idea of what rights should be as universal, trampling roughly over everyone else's beliefs and traditions. We can respond to such criticism as follows. First, while Bentham was right that natural rights had no agreed content or legal legitimacy at that time, today such rights have been given content and agreed to by legislatures and governments. There is no state in the world that has not agreed to abide by at least one human rights treaty. Secondly, the type of rights being promoted abroad is not as alien as is sometimes claimed. Today, although some leaders might seek to brush off human rights criticism as alien or Western, it is more likely that rights will be claimed from the bottom up as part of a campaign to protest against oppression than human rights will be raised in a hectoring way in a summit between leaders. All this does not mean that there is no room for different cultures to choose different outcomes when rights collide. As we shall see, the modern catalog of human rights allows for most rights to be limited in order to take into account the rights of others. Some will say we have still not really proven that these rights exist, beyond laws and treaties, as a question of moral logic for everyone, rather than as a vehicle of convenience for those invoking them. I think that in order to show that human rights are more than just competing claims, and that they reflect a sense that human beings have special worth, we should turn to our increasingly influential idea that human rights are really about protecting human dignity. Mary Wollstonecraft's dedication to Monsieur Talleyrand Perigord in A Vindication of the Rights of Women, 1792. Consider, I address you as a legislator, whether when men contend for their freedom and to be allowed to judge for themselves respecting their own happiness, it be not inconsistent and unjust to subjugate women, even though you firmly believe that you are acting in the manner best calculated to promote their happiness. Who made man the exclusive judge if women partake with him the gift of reason? In this style argue tyrants of every denomination, from the weak king to the weak father of a family. They are all eager to crush reason, yet always assert they usurp its throne only to be useful. Do you not act a similar part when you force all women, by denying them civil and political rights, to remain immured in their families, groping in the dark? For surely, sir, you will not assert that a duty can be binding which is not founded on reason. Karl Marx on the Jewish Question, 1843. It is puzzling enough that a people which is just beginning to liberate itself, to tear down all the barriers between its various sections, and to establish a political community that such a people solemnly proclaims, Declaration of 1791, the rights of egoistic man separated from his fellow men and from the community, and that indeed it repeats this proclamation at a moment when only the most heroic devotion can save the nation, and is therefore imperatively called for at a moment when the sacrifice of all the interests of civil society must be the order of the day, and egoism must be punished as a crime. Declaration of the Rights of Man, etc., of 1793. This fact becomes still more puzzling when we see that the political emancipators go so far as to reduce citizenship and the political community to a mere means for maintaining the so-called rights of man, that therefore the citoyen is declared to be servant of egoistic homme, that the sphere in which man acts as a communal being is degraded to a level below the sphere in which he acts as a partial being, and that finally it is not man as citoyen, but man as bourgeois, who is considered to be the essential and true man. Frédéric Mercier et al., Human Dignity, a special focus on vulnerable groups. The idea of dignity, then, might be something like, do not make me part of a process that is not really about me. Do not make me a collateral victim of some larger goal. It is an appeal, in other words, to not submit individuals to social arrangements, but organize social arrangements according to the individual's dignity. The dignity approach is perhaps, in this respect, more satisfying than delineating a number of core rights, something which inevitably involves awkward and simplistic choices, in that, among other things, different rights matter differently to different people in different times. All rights matter equally, and it is rather each right that has a core and a penumbra, where the core is precisely that area in which dignity is at stake. Dignity. Modern human rights theorists have sought to justify the existence and importance of rights by reference to some overriding value, such as freedom, fairness, autonomy, equality, personhood, or dignity. Following the German philosopher Immanuel Kant, some have sought to derive the logic of human rights from absolute moral principles which can be generated from the following imperatives. First, that each of us has to act according to the principles that we wish other rational beings to act on. And second, that a person should never be treated as a means to an end, but rather as an end in themselves. In the words of the modern philosopher Alan Gerwith, agents and institutions are absolutely prohibited from degrading persons, treating them as if they had no rights or dignity. This is often the starting point for rights theories that emphasize the importance of individual autonomy and agency as primordial values to be protected. The modern philosopher, Jürgen Habermas, stresses the way in which human dignity is the route to egalitarian and universalistic laws, and how human rights are bound up with the creation of democratic institutions that allow for a free flow of ideas and participation. For him, the idea of human dignity is the conceptual hinge which connects the morality of equal respect for everyone with positive law and democratic lawmaking in such a way that their interplay could give rise to a political order founded on human rights, given suitable historical conditions.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.